Yes. The Sri Lanka has a certain role in Buddhism. More, as you're saying, closer to the original, closer in time to the life of Gautama than Thailand or Burma. There are enlightened, fourth stage awakened masters, in Thailand and in Burma and in Sri Lanka and maybe somewhere else, I don't know, in India. But yeah, Sri Lanka was where some critical Buddhist texts went soon after the death of Gautama. And so this site is coming out of Sri Lankan Theravadan scholarship and monasticism. And what he's saying, what one thing that he's talking about is that, in the Eightfold Noble Path, we're talking about right view and, right speech and right action, right concentration, right livelihood, all these different associated with body, mind, and speech, right use of speech, right use of life, and right activity of mind, leading to awakening, concentration, and beginning with right view. So the first of them is right view. And even before right view, we have to consider what is the basis of right view. And one thing that he talked about somewhere in this site, Pure Dhamma, is that the basis of right view is the willingness to consider the reality that there is reincarnation and karma, meaning there are that the self is more than body and mind, therefore has had existence before birth and after death, and therefore there is multidimensionality, meaning there's a realm of being where our sense of self, whatever we are, had experience before birth and after death, therefore multidimensionality, and some willingness to consider or belief in karma, meaning causality, causation, sequence of cause and effect, from before birth through the life to after death into the next lives. And that if people can't accept those two, pretty much reincarnation and karma, and therefore multidimensionality and spiritual identity, not physical material identity. If people can't accept that those views, they can't even get in the door to right view, nor awakening or development of insight. You can't even really go from samadhi to prajna. You can be in virtue and probably be harvestable, living in sila or virtue and ethics and morality and harmlessness. And perhaps, and obviously some Hindus, like the teachers of Gautama before he left them, were teaching about formless jhanas and the formless trances, deeper meditation, states of samadhi, concentration. One can achieve that too, with right view or without right view. But in terms of complete awakening, or really understanding the three marks, anicca, anatta, dukkha, impermanence, insubstantiality, no self, and stressfulness, one must, and really to get in the door, certainly to get to sotapanna, one has to have right view. And that right view is in the world today very, very rare. In some traditional cultures, maybe 500 years ago, lots of people, I guess, believed in reincarnation. Some people over time have believed in karma, but even that is not well accepted globally, socially. So, this is a world mired in wrong view, where most people feel that they're not responsible for their life or what happens to them. They don't recognize karma, causality, or self-authorship responsibility. What Seth said, you create your own reality, what New Age folks say. That's true. Yeah, of course. That's the secret. That's karma. That's been understood, actually by Hindus, even before the time of Gautama, of course. But not everybody understands that. Today, very few do. Karma, self-authorship of body, mind, conditions, and life, of course. And, of course, most people don't recognize reincarnation, or multiple dimensions, or life before birth and after death. Without those views that allow for reincarnation, karma, and multidimensional existence, you can't even get in the door with Buddhism, really. You can get into samadhi, maybe, and maybe you can be virtuous. But you can't really be free of ignorance and free of suffering. Freedom is very limited. I mean, how many people would even do meditation if they don't believe in non-physical or spiritual identity and multidimensionality, karma, reincarnation? Very few people who are the skeptics would even sit down to do meditation, of course. And rejecting karma and reincarnation actually, in practice, generally leads to rejecting morality, rejecting sila or virtue. Because there's the sense of, it doesn't matter. I can do whatever I want, who cares? Because after I take the last breath, it's all over. There is no result and long-term consequence to my activity in this life beyond the last breath. Most people with that view, which is called rational materialism, or materialism, the way of the worldly ordinary folks, you know, which is the New World Order, Illuminati, deceptions. Very few people have some kind of impetus. Why be moral if there's no long-term consequence to my activity? Unfortunately, most people can't get to realize that virtue and giving and goodness is valuable for its own sake, in its own way, intrinsically. Most people don't have that sense, that understanding, outside of a spiritual perspective. Anyway, right view is critical, and it's very difficult to achieve right view in a world of lying authority, deceptive authority, in all fields of human endeavor for the last 15,000 years. So, yeah. Well, yeah, as I've said, as you're saying, there's a difference between path-oriented teaching and spiritual wisdom, you know, portions of wisdom, or curiosities. So, who built the pyramid is sort of a hidden history, spiritual, you know, sensational curiosity. It's a fact. It's transient information. It's not irrelevant. Actually, we can do a lot with it. But if one doesn't go beyond that fact or datum, okay, extraterrestrial group built the pyramid out of thought. Okay, that's cool. Now what? In fact, most people don't go further. How could they do that? What does that say about mind? What does it say about the cosmic plan and multidimensionality, or the nature of the universe as it is beyond the physical? What does it say about extraterrestrial intentions? What does it say about human evolution? What does it say about humanity and social conditions, or the availability of truth? And what does that say about the moral basis of civilization, where we've been lied to, or truths are all hidden, all most important truths are hidden, covered, and muddled? So it's a matter of seeking. Seeking, you'll find, and the intensity and balance and persistence of seeking is critical to awakening and finding. Or finding is critical to awakening. And I don't think that it's, I mean, I think that the guru path is only useful in a one-to-one, very personal framework. If a teacher appears to you physically, and can work very closely and really pretty much living in the same community or keeping a very close relationship, then there's some value to it, so long as that teacher really is completed. But in this world, as it is today, in our situation, I don't think that it's that appropriate because it ends up being that people idealize their teacher and degrade their self-value. It's usually associated with maintenance of low self-value. The idealization or the relationship or the creation of in their mind, their guru. And so I would never consider myself that way because a guru really is somebody who's finished. A Satipana is not a guru. Only a fourth stage awakened in Buddhism is a guru, has that authority because they finished the path. Everybody else has distortion and is not finished with ignorance, avidya. So these days I think it's safer not to join up in any group fully, and because the guru relationship, in my understanding of it, requires a complete voluntary surrender of one's mind and one's life and one's decisions, in a sense, to the guru. And only somebody who's certified completed has that maturity to be able to handle that. And these days, many cases, people want an idealized savior to follow, and they end up binding themselves by that idealization and neglecting aspects of their own self-development. And so there's a difference between a teacher and a guru. Yes, there are teachers coming in dreams. That's true too. And yeah, the greater teachers are higher dimensional anyway. This is not a time of awakened teachers in multiple nations, in multiple traditions available. It's just not that way anymore. 500 years ago, there were some. 1,000 years ago, 2,000 or 1,500 years, 2,500 years ago, yes, there were more, but not all of them, of course. So it's a very sensitive matter, and most people who align to a guru get into trouble. And many people, who go without a guru get into trouble and wrong view too. One of the things that this author of the site indicates is that some people are Sotapanna and they don't know it, obviously. Some people may be Sotapanna and they don't know it. Some people came into this life already Sotapanna. And that in his view, which is very interesting, that there are more people in Sota that are of Sotapanna than we realize in the world today, and it seems to be his view, which probably is from his teachers in Sri Lanka, saying that there may be more people achieving that these days than we would think. So that's interesting. And yes, of course, in general, anybody who achieves any level of awakening was nearby before it occurred. It's like this, the path really is sequential. People may walk the path or transform the seven ray mind body spirit complex system at different speeds. Sure, it's possible to that some people awaken, some people go out of third density faster than others. Some people leave the octave faster than others. Yeah, of course. Transformation of the seven ray system depend the speed depends on will and balance, mainly will and intention. By will and intention, one also values balance and would stay in balanced in balance while, consistently making strong effort without losing balance. That's also a factor of will or a desire for awakening or the light. But anybody who gets to, Sotapanna was nearby before. Anybody who gets to Arahant was nearby before. or at least, you know, obviously making efforts strongly in that direction or towards that goal before. That's pretty clear. But yes, I can imagine some of the people around Gautama were, 3D natives who maybe, I guess, achieved complete and perfect enlightenment. But you see, it's sequential, and so there's achieving Sotapanna is pretty wonderful. Actually, it's really, really critical, and it's more likely that a 3D native would have that achievement rather than already has achieved the first three levels and they're ready for four. I mean, everything, you'll see many things that he says that you'll see that I said, like Shariputra was one of the two chief disciples, and that even Shariputra, in the first paragraph, the first section, no one else can discern what Magga means path, phala means fruit. What path, fruit, one has attained, meaning what level of awakening. The four levels of awakening are called the four magga phala, or phala, I guess it's phala, meaning path, fruit. So Vishuddhi Magga is a book meaning, Vishuddhi is actually the Sanskrit for fifth chakra. Magga is path, so the wisdom path, the path of wisdom. Vishuddhi Magga is a famous text in early Buddhism, not written by Gautama much later, but very important. So nobody can discern what attainment another person has achieved unless they're a Buddha, he's saying, but I would imagine some people would know who are... You see, it's possible to know, but acknowledge that I'm not sure I know. I think I know, but I would only be absolutely sure I know if I'm confirmed by somebody who absolutely is fully awakened. You see, not only, I mean, there are people who have attainment, who see truth, who are not yet fully got a Buddha, who are not Arahant fourth stage. Meaning it's possible to be a Sotapanna or not even a Sotapanna, and in any one case know that somebody else has Sotapanna. However, for that person to be absolutely sure, in my understanding, they'd either have to be told by somebody who's an Arahant or a Buddha to be sure that they're sure. I mean, anybody can have vision, meaning... You know, like, let's look at the first case. He's saying no one else can discern what path, fruit, one or another has attained, Sotapanna or higher. A higher stage of Nibbana, meaning that the four awakenings are considered stages of Nibbana. And though the fourth one is usually only called, you know, Arahant, that leads to complete, perfect enlightenment or Nibbana. But here we're talking, using the phrase stages of Nibbana. So the four levels are stage, four awakenings are stages. He's saying nobody can discern. And in that case, Shariputta didn't realize that that monk was an Arhant. That's heavy, right? Because Shariputta was an Arhant himself. However, I wouldn't say that no Arhant or no one other than a Buddha can see. They can see, but reasonably should not assume that they see. Meaning I can see something, and I can feel that I know it, but I also hold out the possibility that I'm wrong. That's called reasonable. And so I'm sure there were some people around that bhikkhu who thought to themselves, I think he's totally enlightened. And they were not Buddhas. But that doesn't mean one shouldn't assume one has certainty, unless one is an Arahant or a Buddha. But one may be seeing, okay? Meaning, again, I'm sure there were other monks around that particular bhikkhu who had the thought, I think he's a Buddha, or I think he's an Arahant. Of course, that's not impossible. It doesn't, however, for one to be sure that they see clearly, one would have to be, I think, an Arhan or a Buddha only. So only an Arhan or a Buddha would be self-certified or able to self-certify to certainty that their seeing is true. However, there are other people at different levels of awakening who may see some things. Now, interestingly, Sariputta was an Arahant but didn't know that the other bhikkhu was an Arahant. That's heavy. And so here this guy is saying it's not possible for anyone to determine the stage of nibbana of any other person. And again, I would qualify that and say it's not possible for anybody who's not a Buddha, or I think an Arahant, to be absolutely sure that their seeing is absolutely true. But they may actually know it, but they couldn't be sure that what they think they know is true. And I think that's more reasonable. Well, the different, that's a long story too, but a Buddha has a function as world teacher. An Arahant and the Buddha have the same basic awakening or freedom from rebirth. In my understanding, that means both of them are eligible for leaving the octave. Both of them are free of seven-dimensional rebirth. However, a Buddha has a function as world teacher, and by that there are considered certain powers that they have that the Arahant doesn't have. So you can see the difference between Shariputta as an Arahant and Gautama as a Buddha. Gautama knew that that bhikkhu was an Arahant, and Shariputta as an Arahant couldn't see it. But I'm sure Moggallana, with his psychic power, could see it, but would certainly need to be certified or have it affirmed by a Buddha, by Gautama. So you see, these things are very subtle, so we have to be very delicate. But this is a, many, many points he makes here are really wonderful. So he's saying one has to be very careful in dealing with other humans, not to offend anyone intentionally. You could be offending an Arahant. It's just, whether we see who they are, what their level is or not, one should not fall into wrong speech. It's very simple, wrong action, One should, it's not good for us to break Panchashila. It's not good for us to harm physically or kill. It's not good for us to fall into wrong speech or lying. It's not good for us to steal or, theft, thieve. It's not good for us to hurt self or other by drugs or sex, of course. So whether they are a Buddha or an Arahant, or we see it or we don't, doesn't matter in a sense. But he's absolutely right. One doesn't have to become a Buddhist to realize true nature of this world. What he does is he boils down or distills in a very clear, clean way what awakening is. What awakening is a progressive realization of the three marks as it pertains to all of the seven-dimensional experience, all consciousness or samskara or experience of seven-dimensional life, including thoughts, including physicality, including consciousness itself, is of the three marks, meaning it's impermanent, it's no self or insubstantial, and it's stressful. Realizing that, with progressively weakening desires or attachments, is the path. And so that's what he means by realize the true nature of, quote, this world. This world is the seven-dimensional octave, actually, because even higher dimensional beings or someone in a formless realm would need to realize the three marks, anicca, anatta, dukkha, impermanence, insubstantiality, and stressfulness, as they pertain to, all of their experience, even in that higher formless realm. Thank you again. I appreciate this. It's been very rich and deep. Thanks for listening. I hope it's been helpful. Take good care. See you next time.